Mr. Mulhorn now, please.
Thank you, Mr. President. My question is to the Attorney General. On 11th March 2024, a spokesperson from your department said to The Age, "We have always said that we would be raising the age of criminal responsibility to 14 by 2027, accompanied by alternative services that keep young people held to account and out of the justice system. That hasn't changed." Do you stand by this timeline?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Thank Mr. Mulholland for his question. No change.
Mr. Mulholland, supplementary.
Data published this week revealed that young people aged between 12 and 14 breached bail 572 times, many breaking their bail conditions through violent crime. If the law is changed to raise the age of criminal responsibility, many of these young people may not have been charged and convicted of crimes in the first place and would face no consequences for their actions. Will you still proceed with your ill-conceived plan to raise the age of criminal responsibility and put the safety of Victorians at risk?
Minister.
Well, this would have been much better as your substantive question, because it would have given me an opportunity of more than a minute to respond. Today, landmark legislation is going to be introduced into the Parliament in relation to a brand new Youth Justice Act. You are asking me about a proposal in 2027. It hasn't, because what will happen with the Youth Justice Act, what will happen with the approach to intensive bail in relation to electronic monitoring, youth justice workers, a different response is all about responding to the very issues that you have talked about. You can't sit here and go, what happens if you go to 14 now, because we've admitted that's why you wouldn't do it now, because you need to have the services, the programs and the whole justice system working towards, and I'll take up your interjection, Ms. Crozier, we have the lowest youth offending rate in the country. We have a select cohort that we are responding to, and we are in this chamber time and time again telling you those initiatives.
Dr. Mance for the question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Leader of the Government representing the Premier in the Legislative Council. Last week, the Minister for Energy and Resources announced the approval of Beach Energy's Enterprise project. The approval is the final green light for the fossil fuel company to extract dirty methane gas off the coast of Port Campbell. Attorney, the science is clear. We must immediately stop extracting and burning fossil fuels if we are to avoid catastrophic global warming. Why does your government continue to approve new fossil fuel projects?
Minister?
President, I might take your guidance. I welcome your question and I'm more than happy to direct it. But you've literally referenced the Minister's actions and the Minister's comments, but you referred your question to the Premier. And although I can refer it to the Premier and she'll answer, I really question the logic of you being very specific about a portfolio responsibility and not directing it to the relevant Minister. So I'll just give you the option. I don't actually understand why you wouldn't direct it to the Minister for Energy and Resources.
Dr. Mansfield?
I still believe this is a question for the Premier. It's about your government's overall direction on this issue as opposed to an individual minister's decision.
A question can be directed to the Premier. Minister.
As indicated, more than happy to refer that to the Premier.
Dr. Mansfield, supplementary.
Thank you, President, and I thank the Attorney for referring that on. We know that gas forecasts regularly underestimate demand-side solutions. A 2020 report by Northmore Gordon for Environment Victoria found we would not have a gas shortage and roughly halve demand by 2030 if the government increased incentives and programs to move households off gas and towards electrification. Why not take this path rather than the path of drilling for more fossil gas?
Minister.
I'll refer to the Premier.
Minister Stewart with a Minister's statement, please.
Thank you, President. I rise to update the House on the outstanding work of Victoria's Aboriginal community-controlled health sector. We know that we need new and different solutions to reduce the growing health gap between First Nations people and the general population, and ACCOs are at the forefront of this work, delivering culturally safe practices and making meaningful change to the social and emotional wellbeing of First Nations Victorians. Last Thursday, I had the pleasure of attending the Aboriginal Health and Wellbeing Partnership Forum to hear firsthand from ACCOs on their priorities for mental health and social and emotional wellbeing for Aboriginal people in Victoria. I understand that Western models of care do not reflect a holistic approach to social and emotional wellbeing, which goes beyond good mental health and extends to connection to country, culture, spirituality, ancestry, family and community. First Nations people have better health outcomes when the services they access are culturally safe. And I've had the opportunity to visit a number of services and see the power of this work in action. I also want to acknowledge Mick Graham, the CEO of VARS and VACHO chairperson, and Dr. Jill Gallagher, CEO of VACHO, for their leadership in this space and their long-standing commitment to supporting best practice for community social and emotional wellbeing. I look forward to continuing to work with the Forum to not only implement the important recommendations arising from the Royal Commission into the mental health system, but also towards a self-determined mental health and wellbeing system that really delivers and uplifts social and emotional wellbeing for First Nations Victorians.
Ms. Crozier, question please.
Thank you very much, President. My question is to the Minister for Emergency Services. Minister, Labor appointed Tasneem Chopra to the Fire Rescue Victoria Strategic Advisory Committee in 2020. Earlier this month, the Australian Human Rights Commission asked Ms Chopra to, and I quote, step back from duties as an anti-racism ambassador while it investigates a racial discrimination complaint against her. So I ask, will the Minister request that Ms Chopra step back from the FRV committee until this investigation is complete?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Ms Crozier, I can confirm that an investigation is underway in regards to a complaint about some social media activity of a board member who is currently both on the Victorian Public Sector Commission and Fire Rescue Victoria. This investigation is currently underway, it would not be appropriate for me to make any comment further in relation to that matter. However, it's under investigation and I'm not going to make any comment in relation to the specifics of the allegations in relation to that individual. But I do want to say it is the commitment of this government, our values, that we don't tolerate violence or hateful behaviour in our state. Everyone has the right to feel safe, and much of our legislation is designed to respond to issues such as anti-vilification, family violence, supporting women, promoting respectful relationships in schools, and we want to strive for a safer and more tolerant Victoria, and we'll continue in those endeavours.
Ms Crozier, supplementary.
Thank you, President. Well, I understand the Minister didn't go anywhere near to what that really simple question was, just sidestepping it. When asked about social media posts, Minister, made by Ms Chopra, which cast doubt on sexual violence committed by Hamas terrorists against women on October 7, a spokesman for Fire Rescue Victoria said that Ms Chopra was, and I quote, a valued member of FRV. Is this the government's official position also?
Minister.
President, refer Ms Crozier to the answer to her substantive question that I will not be making further comment in relation to a matter that is currently under independent investigation.
When is it going to be finished?
Ms Payne, there's a question, please.
Thank you, President, and I also have a question for the Attorney General. In Victoria, in Australia and all over the world, the rise of AI has resulted in numerous cases of it being used to generate explicit imagery of people without their consent. Victoria has thankfully been proactive in this space. The Justice Legislation Amendment, Sexual Offences and Other Matters Bill 2022 updated image-based sexual offences to capture non-consensual, artificially generated, manipulated or altered images. In light of recent events and the increased use and complexity of AI, it is understandable that people are concerned about whether we have done enough. So my question is, does the law in Victoria adequately respond to the present and future risks that AI presents for the non-consensual generation of explicit imagery?
Minister?
President, I thank Ms Payne for her question, and you raise a really important matter, and I'll take you up on the last part of your question, which talked about are we prepared for the future. It's a really evolving space, and I guess the answer is no, because we don't exactly know where it's all going to go, but we are aware of the risks, we are aware of the concerns, and as you have indicated, we have taken steps in our legislative approach to responding to the emerging incidences of deepfake porn and the like, and we'll continue to monitor the legislative framework and make sure that it is continually updated to respond to emerging concerns. I can assure you that in this space, it is on the national state, it's on the SCAG agenda, and it's something that we're regularly talking about and talking to other states, making sure if other people have got ideas that we can make sure it's transferred across jurisdictions. I would welcome continued feedback from all members of Parliament in relation to this, because it really is an issue that comes up time and time again in new and different ways each and every week. And I know that it's a concerning issue, and I think laws is one way of responding to it, but there are also several programs, particularly in schools, in relation to education about sexting, respectful relationships, love bite programs, and all of these efforts to combat this activity and the harm that it can cause.
Ms. Payne, supplementary.
Thank you, President, and I thank the Attorney for her response. By way of supplementary, some of the recent cases of non-consensual AI-generated explicit imagery have involved school-aged children, both as victims and as perpetrators. This creates an intersection between image-based sexual offences and child exploitation material. So my supplementary is, what is the law in Victoria currently doing to respond to where these offences intersect?
Minister?
I thank Ms. Payne for her question, and there might be an opportunity for you and I to have a more broad conversation offline in relation to that matter, because they're separate offences and you can be charged with both, so the interrelationship of them may be just that they are multiple offences applied. If you've got some specific examples, we can talk through that, but I think it is part of the broader conversation around making sure that we are trying to stay ahead of the curve, respond to the future, and obviously a lot of the offences committed over carriage services is federal remit, so those are conversations that are underway, but more than happy to have a more detailed conversation with you.
Minister Erdogan, Minister's statement.
Oh, thank you, President. I rise today to highlight the remarkable wildlife rehabilitation program at Beechworth Correctional Centre. I had the pleasure of visiting Beechworth last week, where I witnessed the program in action and see firsthand how it exemplifies our commitment to rehabilitation and community reintegration. The Wildlife Rehabilitation Program offers a unique opportunity for people in custody to engage in the care and rehabilitation of injured wildlife, including birds of prey, reptiles and other native Australian species.
Order,
a lot of eagles
order.
And snakes. The program is made possible through the dedicated collaboration between Corrections Victoria and local wildlife rescue groups in northeast Victoria. These groups are often entirely volunteer run, and the partnership with Beechworth Prison gives them more capacity to do their important work. It was great to see participants caring for injured animals with compassion and dedication. The program has aided in the rehabilitation of over 100 animals since the program's beginning. Participants also learn important skills such as wildlife handling techniques and the importance of wildlife conservation. More than 250 people in custody have engaged in the program, fostering a sense of purpose and accomplishment and nurturing a sense of responsibility for the environment beyond the prison walls. But Beechworth Prison is not just a rehabilitation centre for both people and wildlife, it's also a producer of local honey. The Sweet Justice program trains people in custody in beekeeping and honey production. Thankfully, the bees cluster in their hives for winter, making a trip to Beechworth a much sweeter experience. It's wonderful to see how initiatives like these help people break the cycle of reoffending by building skills and providing employment opportunities upon release. The Wildlife Rehabilitation Program and Sweet Justice are great examples of how we can support individuals in custody while contributing positively to our communities and our environment.
Mr. Davis, with a question, please.
Okay. President, my question is to the Minister for Children. Minister, I refer to the Department of Education and Training's submission to the Inquiry and Advisory Committee on the Suburban Rail Loop East, which deals with educational facilities that may be impacted by the construction phase of the government's proposed suburban rail loop. Minister, will there be any social, amenity or environmental impact on early childhood centres near the planned suburban rail loop east? And if so, what steps has the minister or her department taken to ensure the health of young people, young children, is not put at risk?
Sit down. No, Mr. Davis, I haven't said it. I just.
You can't walk I didn't even give.
Well, a couple of things. I didn't give you a call. The call, and the other thing is, I just stuttered. So I hadn't a chance to. My concern is the Minister for Infrastructure might be the appropriate minister. Under executive orders. But I'm happy if the minister wants to answer the question as she sees fit.
Thank you, President, and I would support your initial inclination, which is that under the general orders, the relevant ministers would be those with responsibility for the suburban rail loop. But I will welcome any opportunity to talk about all of the initiatives that we are implementing under Best Start, Best Life, which go to, and just in the past week, have announced more than $28 million in ensuring that the amenity of our kindergartens, be they ensuring that playgrounds have disability access, through to ensuring that kindergartens have IT equipment, such as the centre at Baxter that I was very pleased to visit last week with the member for Hastings, and they were very excited to receive their grant for their local IT infrastructure. But right across our state, whether they are attached to or beside the suburban rail loop or otherwise, we are upgrading kindergarten facilities because we know that 3- and 4-year-old kinders.
Mr. Davis, on a point of order.
Very specific question about education department assets, assets near the suburban rail loop. It relates to the department's own submission. Davis. It does not relate
Mr.
to
it's not a point
childcare
of order.
Centres all around Victoria.
Order. The Minister made a clear answer that this doesn't fall under her responsibilities under the executive order, and that's an answer. So,
President, she can't just say that if it does. She can't be wrong in what she says. The department's immediate interests include school sites and assets.
No. If you've got other provisions to you, you can take, if you believe that you're right, you can take move a motion to take note of the minister's answer, or you can move a separate motion in that view during notice of motion. But the minister's answer was clear that it doesn't fall under her responsibility under the executive orders, and that's the answer.
On to the point of order, the minister can't say something that is false. If it does fall under her area, her department has actually made a submission about facilities, including early childhood facilities.
Sit down, Ms. Davis. I'm on my feet. This isn't something that I have decided should come into vogue today. There are many rulings around this. Many rulings around if it doesn't fall within the minister's responsibility under the executive, but the minister has every right to say it does not. You have other provisions if you believe it's not correct, but the minister has clearly and had said that's her answer, and that's the end of it. As the minister finished her minister, so and Mr. Davis, you've got a problem now because I know you want to ask a supplementary question, but it's going to be very difficult to ask a supplementary question after the minister said that it's not falls into her responsibility. But I'll invite.
The department's
Is this supplementary or what's this?
The Department of Education's submission to the Suburban Rail Loop panel said there is a potential impact for contaminated land or migration of contaminated groundwater during operation of the project, which could impact department schools. And in another part, it also talks about other facilities as well. And in that circumstance, where the department's own submission, the Department of Education, your department's submission, says there's contaminated land and spoil management issues, migration of contaminated land water, and indeed the potential land stability issues, does the minister support the department's submission, or does she have a different view from her own department?
And once the submission is made, it's the responsibility of the Minister for Transport Infrastructure. So,
does she support her own department's submission?
Once the submission is made, it's a responsibility of the Minister for Transport Infrastructure. I'll call the Minister without any great expectation that she might have a different position. Minister.
Thank you very much, President. And the question is indeed flummoxing, because the answer to the question is within the question itself, which is it is a submission by the Department of Education to the responsible authority, and the responsible authority, as I indicated in my substantive answer, we support improving the amenity and protecting the amenity of every kindergarten across this state, and that is why under the Best Up, Best Life reforms, we're investing $14 billion in a generational reform. But the submission is to the responsible authority, which is the Suburban Rail Loop, which is where you should have directed your question, Mr. Davis.
He's 2 weeks in a row. He's
Order. Mr. Davis, on a point of order?
No, President. I move that the Minister's answer to step away from her department's submission be taken into account on the next day of meeting.
Mr. Davis, I can't put that question. Do you want to put another question?
President, I move that the Minister's answer be taken into account on the next day of meeting.
Question is much to be agreed to. All that opinion, say aye.
Aye.
Against, no. I believe the ayes have it. Ms. Purcell, the question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister for Agriculture in the other place. In March, a shocking case of bestiality was captured by whistleblowers from the Farm Transparency Project at Midland Bacon in my electorate. In the footage, a man can be seen committing multiple forms of sexual violence on a sow trapped inside a farrowing crate. Shockingly, not all of his heinous acts are considered illegal in Victoria. While we have called for strengthened laws to prevent this happening to more animals, at the same time, almost 27,000 people signed a petition demanding that this individual pig, now named Olivia, be rescued from the industry and released to a sanctuary. Yet to this day, she remains at the very scene of the crime. Will the Minister intervene to ensure the safe release of Olivia the pig?
Minister representing the Minister for Agriculture. Yeah.
I'll refer that to the Minister.
Ms. Purcell, supplementary.
Thank you, President, and thank you, Attorney, for referring that on. The 730 report that detailed Olivia's horrific abuse also revealed the extreme confinement pigs are subjected to in farms across Victoria. The standard size of sow stalls and farrowing crates are roughly the same size as a fully grown pig. It's not possible for them to turn around, let alone escape from physical violence. Acknowledging the extreme cruelty of sow stalls, the pork industry announced they would volunteer to phase out their use by 2017. 7 years on, and the most recent footage captured by whistleblowers showed that they are still being used. Will the government finally legislate a complete ban on sow stalls and farrowing crates in their new animal care and protection legislation?
Minister.
I'm happy to refer it. I just don't think it relates to this substantive question, but I can refer it.
Ms. Purcell, would you like to rephrase the supplementary question so it refers to the substanding? No. So we'll get you to respond to the substanding. Thank you, Minister. Minister Blanford, Ms. Stamen.
Thank you, President. As Minister for Children, visits to services such as kinders, MCH or out-of-home care facilities provide an important opportunity for children, parents and families to speak directly with me about their experiences. Last week, I was scheduled to visit a supported family playgroup. President, I can't hear myself, so I suspect the Chamber can't hear me either.
Can the clerk, do you mind resetting the clock?
What a singer that was.
And the Minister's not being provocative. The Minister can hear it in silence.
Thank you, President. As Minister for Children, visits to services such as kinders, MCH or out-of-home care facilities provide an important opportunity for children, parents and families to speak directly with me about their experiences. Last week, I was scheduled to visit a supported family playgroup at the Jindai Family and Community Service Community Centre in Moonda to do just that. Supported family playgroups funded by the Victorian Government provide children, parents and carers and opportunities to learn and grow together through play-based activities. This was a visit requested by the operator, the Brotherhood of St. Lawrence, and it was a visit I was very much looking forward to. But due to threats from anti-Israel protesters, the Brotherhood of St. Lawrence recommended the visit to the centre be cancelled. According to the Brotherhood, the threats were such that it was concerned about the long-term impacts on kids and parents of the playgroup space being the target of the protest. The Brotherhood of St. Lawrence advised that parents and carers were concerned about their and their children's safety and well-being. President, threats by anti-Israel protesters to the safety and well-being of children and families need to be called out. It is unacceptable on the steps of Parliament, it is unacceptable in a family playgroup, it is unacceptable anywhere, and these are the actions of authoritarian thugs. I hope that all members in this place will condemn protests which pose a threat to the safety and well-being of children and families. I note that the Brotherhood of St. Lawrence tried to mitigate the threat, proposing extraordinary measures such as deploying additional staff and enhanced screening of visitors, and I pay tribute to their staff, their professionalism and dedication to the safety and well-being of the community they serve. All these protesters achieved was to rob families, carers and children of their voice, of an opportunity to speak directly to their minister about their experiences. President, I will keep visiting services across Victoria and I refuse to let parents, carers and children be disenfranchised by an aggressive, anti-democratic minority because children, parents and carers deserve nothing less.
Mr. Mulholland, a question please.
Thank you, Mr. President. My question is to the Minister for Corrections. During her appearance at PAEC, the Commissioner for Corrections noted that defects discovered at both newly built Melbourne Remand Centre and Barwon Prison mean both facilities are now being reviewed. Minister, what defects were discovered that need a review to take place?
Minister.
I thank Mr. Mulholland for his interest in our correction system and our investments in our corrections infrastructure. I think as a government we've been very upfront about the need to upgrade and improve our system, remembering that when we came into government we inherited a system that was over capacity at ageing infrastructure.
Of course.
A government we've made investments to improve the system across the system. So we make no apologies for making those investments. I think in relation to that question, I do recall that question by Mr. O'Brien, and I want to thank him. He was very engaging in the PAEC process, and I want to thank him for the participation. I think it's important that we have those processes in place, and as Minister, I've been very upfront. Mr. O'Brien was the one that asked the question. I'll take the interjection, Mr. McGowan. Mr. O'Brien was the one that asked the question about that facility. But I mean, we invested in upgrades.
Mr. Mulholland, on a point of order.
Oh, sir, a generous amount of time. It was a very specific question to ask what defects were discovered that need require a review to take place, and I'd ask the minister to stay relevant to that.
Yeah. And I think the minister was responding to part of the preamble, and I'll call the minister to the answer. Minister.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Mr. Mulholland. We've invested in in upgrading our facilities, and the prison infill expansion is part of that. But in relation to the programs that Mr. O'Brien asked, was that that project is not yet complete, and the department is managing those contracts to make sure that the new infrastructure meets the quality expected. So there's still a process, and as you know, those ops have been out of government for a long time, so they may understand that when you have large infrastructure projects, defects can be do come up, and it's my expectation that they're rectified. There'll be a process, but these upgrades are not yet required due to the low numbers in custody. So we're in a...
Ms. Mulholland, a point of order.
It wasn't you that answered the question. The question I was asking pointed out that it was the Commissioner that answered the question in regards to the defects that were found. And we want to know which defects.
That's not a point of order, Minister. Minister?
Mr. Mullen, in relation to this program, this project, they're still not complete. There's going to be a process about the defects. As Minister, I get regularly briefed by the department about what needs to be improved. In relation to the defects, there'll be an investigation, there'll be recommendations, but I think we need to understand, we need to protect the commercial position of the state in relation to these. With any large infrastructure project, I expect that the quality that the government signed up to is met.
Mr. Mulholland, supplementary.
Thank you. Minister, isn't it a fact that there is black mould that requires major works and possible demolition of the two new facilities due to safety issues?
Wow. Minister.
Thank you, President. I thank Mr. Mulholland for the supplementary. As I stated in my substantive, construction is not yet complete. And where there are defects, it's my expectation is that they're rectified. The department's working through with the contractors to make sure that they are brought up to scratch. In relation to that process, I'm not going to say anything in this chamber that may compromise the position of the state. That would be irresponsible. But in the meantime, we're in a good position in Victoria. We have ample capacity in our system, unlike when those ops were in government. We've invested in infrastructure across the board and modernised the system, and we'll keep doing that. Thank you. Nothing with you lot.
A whole point of order.
I move by leave to take the Minister's answer into consideration on the next day of meeting.
The question is motion to be agreed to. All those in say aye.
Aye.
Against no. I believe the ayes have it. Mr. Puglioli, have a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is to the Minister for Mental Health. We saw reports over the weekend that Labor is preparing to unwind its previous opposition to the service of pill testing, also known as drug checking, something which, as we all know, was long opposed by former Premier Daniel Andrews. We've heard that the new Premier supports a year-long pill testing trial and that a proposal is in fact headed to Cabinet. There should be no more delays from Labor in introducing this service that will help keep people safe. It is long overdue. We must see the Cabinet convinced that the introduction of pill testing will save lives. Too much is at stake. Will the plan that's been referred to in these reports include a fixed site service for detailed analysis for the broader community year-round?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and I thank Mr. Puglioli for his question and his strong interest in these issues. And we've had many conversations about the importance of harm minimisation when it comes to drug and alcohol services right across the state. And look, the reality is there are a lot of things that are in the media, but the facts are, and what is guiding the government right now is we saw a lot of harm last summer during the festival season where we saw a number of critical emergencies, overdoses and sadly fatalities associated with a number of different substances, but also it must be said the heat conditions in parts of the state during the festival season last summer. So of course the government, and I think we've been on the record, both the Premier and myself, in regard to these matters, we have sought advice from our department about the best way forward in terms of future government decisions in this area. I'm waiting for that advice, and once I receive that advice, the government will give it careful consideration.
Mr. Puglioli, supplementary.
Thank you, President. The moment that we're in right now, particularly as we're about to go into a parliamentary sitting break, this needs to be a moment where we see drawn a line in the sand that this is the moment to get on with pill testing. Those who reportedly support it within the government need to convince their cabinet colleagues that now is the time, join the list of other states and territories who have implemented this service and get on with the work of protecting people. The expert advice, the evidence, is endless. It works, it's up and running in the ACT, Queensland, even now New South Wales through their injecting room site. Every summer, as the Minister said, we see more harm, the risk of more deaths. There is no reason that Labor can't move forward with this right now. Will drug checking be available to Victorians in time for the summer festival season to save lives?
Minister.
Thank you, President. And whilst I can appreciate the desire on the part of a number of people in the chamber, to have answers to these questions, I have been pretty clear, and that is that we are awaiting the expert advice, and it will be the expert advice that the government takes into consideration when it considers it carefully, and government decisions are part of a process, as members would well know, and we are simply not at that point today, and we will wait for the expert health advice, which is what we've sought.
Minister Symes, Minister Statement.
President, I would like to update the House on the work our community legal centres are doing to deliver positive outcome for Victorians, particularly women and children. Along with Ms Watt, I had the pleasure of visiting Women's Legal Service to learn more about their critical work they do as a specialised community legal centre, and a fantastic organisation absolutely dedicated to supporting disadvantaged women address their legal and other needs. They provide wraparound services where clients are not only assisted by lawyers but also supported by social workers and financial counsellors. It's this kind of practical support that really improves the outcomes for women, and particularly those who are experiencing family violence. Recently, I also visited the Ballarat and Grampians Community Legal Centre to meet their team and thank them for the important work they do, and many members in the chamber would be familiar with their work because they cover 12 local government areas across Central Highlands and Wimmera region, encompassing a population of 250,000 people. Like many CLCs, their work is extensively with women and families, providing legal information as well as legal representation and assistance, conveniently located right down the street from the Ballarat Specialist Family Violence Court. This CLC delivers important services, and they continue to play a key role in supporting family violence victims, survivors. We do know that Ballarat has been deeply affected by violence against women. Samantha Murphy, Rebecca Young and Hannah Maguire, all from Ballarat, are just three of the women who have lost their lives at the hands of men's violence this year. It's why we announced that Ballarat will be the location of our saturation model pilot, bringing together new and expanded programs, policies and services with one focus to drive down the rates of family violence and men's violence against women. Our CLCs understand that access to the law is crucial in our response to combating violence against women, and I thank all of those organisations for their commitment to individuals who need their help.
And that ends Minister's statements and questions without notice.